Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.
Welcome to Big Green Thursday. Today, we have an exciting, we're going to meet some ferns, and they're fronds. So this is a little bit different than what we've done in the past, and of course we have our frond expert, Dr. Jeff Leister, who's also a master gardener and a botanist, and he has many hats. So he's here to teach us all about ferns and their fronds, and enjoy the show.
Very good. Thank you, Chris. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
I see some repeats in here. I gave this earlier, and I guess we're back for a second go-around, I guess. So thank you for coming. Yes, this morning, so we're going to talk about ferns, and we're also introduced a new one that Chris wanted to include, and that's the spike moss. Not really a moss, but we'll talk about it. Be sure to get a handout there, and my email address is at the bottom of the front page. And at the bottom, you will find my email address, because this page has all active links on it. So if you, I'll send you the actual document, and all you have to do is click with a mouse to get out to the website. So you don't have to type in the long URL string there. And the one really critical thing about growing ferns, there's a really good publication. It's free, PDF file, from the University of Georgia. Was updated in 2015, and it's entitled Growing Ferns, and it's an excellent document. So if you want to be sure to download that one, if you're going to buy some ferns at our plant sale, you might want to have this as a ready reference on the planting. So this morning, let's get started. Over at the side over here, you'll notice I have fronds that I picked this morning from my yard. Potted this up from my rain garden yesterday, and these are from my yard, but these all these ferns from here on are exotic. They're not native here. So when you look at these, they're not native. Now they do well here when you plant them. Some of them will be on our plant sale, but they just are not native to North Carolina. These, however, all of this grouping here are native ferns to the East Coast, so that's how I've got them divided up. And then the selaginella, a little spike moss we're going to talk about, I have up here, and I'll pass that around. So anyway, need to man up and choose a fern, and it looks like we're low on man this morning.
Always.
Always. But I'm glad we have a few here. So, as Chris indicated, I'm a master gardener, and have real interest in ferns. My background is seaweeds, but I love having ferns around because they are part of that lower plant group that evolved very early in time. So meet the ferns and their frond spike, and spike is up here, so we'll talk about spike. So this morning we'll do a little bit about plant classification. We'll talk about the kingdom Planta and some of the seven divisions we'll just mention. We're not going to go into detail. Talk about the four classes of extant. You know what that word means?
Existing,
that's right. Versus extinct. So these are extant. These are the four groups that have survived time and are still present here on planet Earth. And we'll kind of start at the beginning and look at how this all occurred. Talk about the evolution of land plants a little bit, since these are basically land plants. They're not aquatic. Some of them are aquatic. Talk about the spike moss, which is the genus Selaginella. Sometimes you see this as spike moss written as one word. The thing to realize is that it's not truly related to the mosses at all. So I'll keep trying to pound that home. And then we'll talk about true ferns. And most of these are all true ferns over here. We'll talk about the external morphology. We'll talk about a native fern, the Christmas fern, as an example in the life history, which goes across all the ferns, same basic life history that you have. And in the document on growing ferns, that's the first thing they talk about is the life history of the fern. So it's nice to have an understanding of how these things make a living and how they reproduce. Fern propagation, I'll talk a little bit about that. I'll talk about some unusual ferns. I'll have photos of some unusual ferns. List of selected native ferns. That's on the back of this sheet, so you should have a list of those. And these are all basically from the common here in North Carolina. You can get them in North Carolina. We had trouble, I think, Chris, tell me, getting samples of cultivated native ferns that we can sell at the plant sale. Is that correct?
We are going to have some Christmas fern.
Christmas fern. Okay, that's been added. Okay.
So, yes. It is hard to find them in the nursery.
Right.
Great.
And the ostrich fern is also native, so that we're having that one. So yeah,
that as well.
Too. Right. So talk about the sort of four basic groups of land plants. You can divide them into spore-bearing plants, that is, they give rise to spores, versus seed-bearing, they give rise to seeds. In the spore-bearing plants, you basically have the ferns, the mosses, and algae. I gave a talk earlier in the year on mosses and algae and liverworts and hornworts, so we sort of covered that one. But in the seed-bearing plants, you have the gymnosperms, you have the pine cones, and have seeds in the pine cone. And then the angiosperms, of course, most of us have those as perennials in the garden. Those are divided usually into monocots, so one cotyledon versus dicots with two cotyledons. So those are kind of the basic arrangement of how we view plants on more of the sort of the simplistic scale. So again, here are the sort of basic groups. We have the bryophytes. Ferns and fern allies. The fern allies are closely related to ferns, but are not true ferns. We have gymnosperms and we have angiosperms. So most of you recognize ferns. Mosses, of course, most of us have mosses in our yard. Liverworts are not as common, but you'll find these in nurseries a lot. Lycophytes, these are the ground pines that are native here in North Carolina. It's a protected plant. Pine, of course, there's the pine cone, and we have cycads. We have cycads that are found and can be grown here. They're not native. So, passion flower, which is a native vine, and then of course tulip poplar, examples of angiosperms. So here's the sort of the plant classification. So if we look at some of the divisions, so we start off with the kingdom first, and next in line underneath that, we have plant divisions. And start off with the algae up here, and then the mosses are included here. We have other ones down here that you see. I'm not going to talk too much about those, but those are basically lead up to the angiosperms, dicots and monocots in this division. We're going to focus on this one right here today, so the Pteridophyta, and consists of the fern, spike moss, moss-like, club moss-like, club moss, they're not mosses either, and then horsetails. So we're going to focus on those. The etymology of the word pterido means fern, and of course, phyte, as you might know, means plant, so pteridophytes. We have the like Sapopsida, which is the club mosses, include the club mosses, the selaginellas, the spike mosses, and acilites. The quillworts are all included under this class. There are three other classes. Equisetum, which is the horsetails. We have the whisk ferns, which is another one that's not really a fern, but picked up the names over time when they were really named. And then we have the class Phyllocopsida, which is the true ferns. So we're going to be focusing on this order and in this class, and then we're going to talk about the ferns here. So so here's the moss-like order. This is the running cedar or the southern ground pine, a protected plant here in North Carolina. People went out and stripped whole areas of forest to make their wreaths for the winter. It's a protected plant. These are the strobili. These are the where the spores are produced. Here's the spike moss. This is Selaginella. This is Krauss spike moss over here. And that's the one I have up here, which you can see growing in my rain garden. And then the peacock fern, again, it's not a fern. Selaginella, this is the one that will be at the plant sale. So it has a sort of bluish tinge to it. It's quite spectacular. Here are the quillworts. These are aquatic and a very ancient plant, but they sort of grow, look like grass. But the reproductive structure at the base of these, the base of the plant, they root usually along the edges of pond and actually in water. So this is a really ancient group of plants. And then, of course, the horsetails, which most of you know are sometimes called the scouring rush. These grow along stream beds. Early settlers used to grab these up and use them to scour their pans with it because they have silica in the cell walls. So there's a silica. And of course, the unusual thing is how they kind of snap apart. If you've ever taken one, they'll pull apart. They're jointed here. This is the strobila. This is where the spores are produced up here when it's formed. These are the whisk ferns. Again, not a true fern, but they do have the sporangia showing here. Sometimes called the skeleton fork fern, and you can see it growing here among the rocks. But this is quite an early developed plant, unusual looking. Then we have these true ferns. So here's a giant fern. You can see the size of those, and then of course here are the true ferns. Here's the native New York fern in Pisgah National Forest, and here's another group of ferns, same way, the New York fern there. My largest fern is this one, which is the royal fern, which does really well in my rain garden. So that's the biggest frond or friend I have in there. So that's the royal fern. So if we look at the evolution of land plants, based on, again, early geological history, spores that are found, fossils that are found. You can start off with an ancestral green alga of some sort. Liverworts, hornworts, mosses probably were derived from this early time. We're going to focus really on this group right here. So vascular plants about 425 million years ago when they first appeared. So we have the lycophytes, which are the club mosses, the spike mosses, and the quillworts that we just showed pictures of. And then we have the true ferns over here, horsetails and whisk ferns. So from the beginning, we'll go back billions of years ago, and I kind of like this drawing. You've seen this one before, many of you. But it basically starts off with sort of our Big Bang. We're not talking about the TV series. The Big Bang theory. And coming around here, these are in billions of years. So we come around over here all the way to where we are now. And here we are, Homo sapiens, 200,000 years ago when we first appeared. So we're just a little bit on the scale right down here, not much to show. Spike mosses, however, were here much before we were. And there would be 400 to 425 million years ago they first appeared here. So again, based on fossil records, the spores and so forth that have been found, we've sort of pinpointed it to that point in time. So here's the spike moss over here, mixed in with sphagnum moss. It's a moss here, but here's the spike moss over here. About 800 species of spike mosses, mainly tropical, a lot of the tropical forms. They extend into the Arctic regions in both hemispheres. They're not in Antarctica, however. Leaves spirally arranged in ranks of usually four, and you can see that when you look at the plants closely, and secondary and on the ultimate branchlets. Spores are born near the axils of the sporophylls, which are usually at the tip of the plant. The spike at the top is where they're formed. We'll see a little example of that in a minute, but usually four-sided strobila. Here's the diversity of the forms of Selaginella. So you can see that there's quite a diversity here. Mm-hmm. This is just one example of just a few of the forms. Another grouping here showing the various forms of the spike moss. You can see why there's some 800 species. So again, spike moss, the Selaginella. Here's the strobili are found up here at the tips, and they produce two kinds of spores in this case at the tips. One's called a microspore, and the other one's a megaspore, and they give rise to sperm and one to eggs. Mm-hmm. So again, much like the ferns and the mosses, it requires a source of water in order to have fertilization occur when it occurs in nature. So again, they'll give rise to the, we'll look here quickly. Oh, I'll warn you now, we're going to get into some sexually explicit images of spike moss's reproductive behavior. So some of you may want to leave. It's fine until I get through this part. But here we go. The spike moss is here. And you'll notice this part is the part that we see here is what we're talking about, is this part right here. And right here is the strobilus at the top, where it has these modified sporophylls that produce megasporangia and microsporangia. And those eventually will drop off to the soil, and they will sort of open up. And in water, they produce male gametophyte will produce sperm. So the sperm then are swimming around in the water, and hopefully they'll come across a megaspore that has opened. And inside there are where the eggs are located. And once that in that film of water, the sperm will find its way there. And if it gets lucky, we'll get a fertilization occurring here, and it'll develop into the new sporophyte. So this phase down here, again, occurs on the ground in a film of water, if it's there, and it can occur in nature. So. But it's an unusual form of reproduction. And these megaspores and microspores are evident in the fossil record. They find them, they usually are sort of covered, yes.
Question, is there a particular fertile, quote unquote, time for this?
Usually in the midsummer or so, they'll begin to form. So I've got these little Selaginella I have not formed the reproductive structures yet. So eventually they will, yeah. But.
And so when it rains and it lays down a puddle of water, that's when it's happening.
It's usually a film of water. That's when these would drop. If these have already dropped, these stay dormant sort of until the rain comes along or it gets wet, and then they will open up, release sperm, and the eggs will be available then. Fertilization can occur. Mm-hmm. So we look at the spore-producing part up here. Phyte means plant, so it's a spore-producing plant. So we call it a sporophyte. And all of these ferns over here, for example, are all sporophytes. They're all diploid. We don't see the gametophyte phase usually. It's microscopic. That's why they sometimes call them cryptogams. They're cryptic gametes, because they usually take a microscope or something to see them. So below here, this is all haploid. So when this occurs here, we have meiosis occurring, and you all know about meiosis. That gives rise to the sperm, and meiosis occurs to give rise to the eggs. So that produces what we call the haploid phase. Once fertilization occurs, you get the diploid phase, which will germinate the zygote, and then you get the sporophyte generation over here. So gametophytes produce gametes. So when you talk about the gametophyte, and again, I don't have any gametophytes in here right now. You don't see any, so they're just, again, cryptic. Here's the strobili example here of Selaginella. You see the normal sort of pattern of the leaves, and then the sporophyll strobilus is up here with these modified leaves, which are called now sporophylls because they produce spore producing production. Over here, this is the female, this is the megaspore. And then these little ones right here are hiding the microsporangia that occur there. So they all occur on the same little strobilus or branch, as you see here. This is taken in my backyard. This is in the rain garden. And this is the golden tip cultivar. Again, that's the one I have up here. But it grows very close to the ground and kind of creeps across, producing a really nice ground cover. A little close up there, golden tip. And again, a close up there showing the leaves. But it's right here at these tips is where the strobili will be produced if it's going to go reproductive. And you may have heard about the resurrection plant. This is a selaginella that's common out in the northern desert, northern Mexico, and southwestern United States. But it survives basically desiccation in the desert conditions. It's often called like a tumbleweed because it all coils up when it's dry and dislodges from the soil and will blow around as these little tight balls until rain comes along. This is time lapse taken over a 5-hour period with every 5 minutes a frame was taken and then it was all put together. So this is a sort of amazing plant the way it bursts open. So all they did was set the thing in water. And so you can imagine when the rain hits it, this is what occurs. So so it's a kind of an unusual selaginella, and again, it's not native to our part of the country, but is found around the world. Some sources for these, if you're interested in getting some spike mosses like in your garden, Niche Gardens has a couple of them. I think this is the one that we will have right here at the plant sale. And then Bernie Eye, this is the other one here. That's again,
$5.
Yeah, these are $12. What a bargain! And then Plants Delight, of course, has quite a few examples of selaginellas that, if you're interested in going there and getting them, so we do have some local sources. Kerr's nurseries, a lot of the native ones don't have these available, so there's. They're not readily available. Any questions about spike mosses? Selaginella, very interesting plant and group. So if we go back now, we're going to talk about our ferns. And they began to appear about 320 million years ago, so well ahead of the, or well before the spike mosses, which were up in here. Down here, you might be interested, this is flowers and bees. So those occurred about 100 million years ago. And they're tied together. So bees and our flowering plants actually evolved together. So that's why you find this dependence on honeybees and pollination on a lot of our plants that we like that are bee friendly. So again, we'll talk about the ferns now. And parts of the fern can basically be divided. And you usually have a root system, and there's a rhizome, which is basically the stem of that. You have a fiddlehead, and examples of the ones that are growing, you'll see examples of fiddleheads over there. You have the stipe or petiole, as it's called, and these extensions off the side are pinny, like pinny on a feather. So these are all have multiple pinny on it. A pinnule is usually something that comes off of a fern. So if I hold up this frond here, you will see these are individual pinnae here, and then the pinnules are here, are these right here. So pinnae and pinnules, so that's what this is. And of course, this is one frond. This is not multiple leaves. This is one leaf from that I took off the plant. So. That's kind of interesting. And the other big one, this is, of course, this is the wood fern, Dixie wood fern, and you can see it's divided the same way. It has the pinnules and pinnae on it. And these are all basically, if you turn over, when you look at these, turn them over, you'll see the sporangia, which we're going to talk about in more detail.
So, question.
Yeah.
In New England, they would eat the fiddlehead.
Oh.
Did you know that?
I know that. Oh, that's terrible.
Well,
why would you want to eat
it? Taste terrible.
Oh, do they? You taste them. Yeah, I know. They do serve them, yes.
Yeah.
And they're renewable. They're sustainable, so they can, yeah. So fiddleheads are, you know, very tender, and they can they'll usually fry them in something and put them on top. So yeah,
they're not very good.
Okay. So this whole structure right here would be called the blade, and from all the way down, including the petiole, that would be the frond, as we refer to it. The rachis usually runs up through the middle where the pinnae are attached. And then the vein in the middle of a pinnule is called a costa. So sometimes you'll use this in identifying a fern. So here's the diversity, a little bit of diversity of the shape and of fern fronds. So you can see that it's quite an array. And I think there are about 10,000 species of fern. So this is just a sampling of what some of them look like. Rhizome growth can be different. You have creeping forms. The rabbit fern over here, you notice, has a sort of a creeping rhizome on it, and then a short creeping rhizome in some cases. So the maidenhair fern is an example of that, and then ascending rhizome, which comes up out of the pot. That's an example here. An ascending rhizome is on this plant over here, so it kind of sticks above the soil a little bit as it grows. So those are different sort of growth habits. And then we have the sori. And the sori basically are these little spots that occur that a lot of people will call into the helpline and they'll wonder what's wrong with their fern. They got something growing on the back of it. And they're just, it's natural. It's a sporangia that are forming. It's always on the back of the leaf, not on the top of the leaf or the front side of the leaf or frond. And you'll see them as little patches. So the wood fern, the Christmas fern, and the hay-scented fern, they all have different ways in which the sporangia form. And those are uniquely characteristic to the genus and the species. Here's the maidenhair fern. You can see it's usually on the edges of the fern pinnule. Polypoly fern, this is the one that has it right on the top. You can see right up the middle of the pinnule. So this pattern of the way these sori are arranged is critical in identifying the fern. The spori now also have what are called an indusium, which is a little covering over the sporangia. And you can see the covering here. This is Seibold's wood fern, and then here's Maris, the maidenhair fern. And you can see it along the edges here of the fern. And underneath there, if you were lift that little flap, you'll find the sporangia produced there. So, and they have various ways. They have the cup-shaped indusium, and there's the sporangia, multiple sporangia, kidney-shaped form, which is this one right here, marginal fern, this is a marginal one right here. Then they have a round one, which is kind of attached in the middle and kind of just sits on top of the sporangia, protecting it. The stipe of the fern is quite unique. These all, you can go to the family group based on what the vascular system looks like. These are just cross sections taken of various petioles that show the arrangement of the vascular tissue. And I was showing Chris, when I pulled up the painted Japanese fern, there were some little things sticking out the end here. You can see them here. And that's part of the vascular bundle. That's a part of this that carries water and nutrients to and from the frond. So vascular bundles, this is what these are. These are vascular bundles. Look at, they have unique sort of shapes to them. Here's the Christmas fern. So it has it sort of spread out like this. But that pattern is unique. Again, it can be identifying character for ferns. So let's consider one of our native ferns. We'll talk a little bit about the Christmas fern. How many of you have this in your yard, Christmas fern? Yeah. So it's one of our natives, and this is what it looks like in the summer, mixed in with stilt grass. evergreen Christmas, so this is taken in the winter, and it is evergreen, so which is nice to have in the landscape, as are some of the Korean and ferns over here, the autumn fern and the Korean tassel fern, the holly fern. These are sort of semi-evergreen and will last during the winter, so it'll give you something in the yard. So here's part one of life history of the Christmas fern, and talk about the sporangia, which are produced with release of spores. If you look at the underside, this is what it would look like with the sporangia, and I'll pass a few of these around. You can look at the tips of these and see that they there are sporangia right at the tip of the branch on the back side of the leaf. One back here. So this is the Christmas fern. So we have the sterile peony here, which are, you can see this little projection here on it. So they're in discrete clusters right at the tip. If you go at the tip of that branch I just passed around, you will see, maybe you can look at this here. Right at the top, you can see that the sporangia are located at the tip. And it's nothing going wrong with the plant. It's part of perfectly normal. So you'll see right at the tip, these vary on the upper penny, these numerous sori. And you look a little, here's a sterile one right here. Here, if you turn it over, here's a fertile one. And you can see the indusium that covers it. Here's a cross-section of the indusium, so it shows that little cover. And then multiple sporangia underneath, hanging there. So again, here's a fertile tip. Here are the individual sporangia over here. And they have a unique way of dissipating the spores. So the sporangia have these what are called annulus cells, and they're sort of thickened. So when it dries, it begins to rupture. And when it does rupture, a break occurs very quickly, and it kind of flings the spores out. So this is what occurs here, showing the flinging of the spores. So ejection of the spores. So it actually ejects them, and if there's a slight breeze or wind, it will carry those spores. And here's a couple of spores that I took a photograph of from the Christmas fern. It has these a heavy wall around it, so they will not dry out. They're protected by a waxy coating. And again, you can see the annulus. This is the annulus right here. So I squashed one under the slide, under the scope, and these are the spores that were liberated from it. But that's the thing that will snap open and spread these spores. And what I did was a little experiment a couple years ago. I took some bricks, old bricks I had, that soaked them in water, made sure they were hydrated, treated them with Clorox first, basically. But anyway, I started to grow those on the spore, just sprinkle the spores on the brick, and this is what germinated. So these spores basically are what are called prothallii. So these are gametophytes. So this is the gametophytic stage of the fern. And this is the part here. So the gametophyte, this little heart-shaped phallus that forms, it's usually only a single layer of plant cells. And underneath there is on this back side, you will find archegonia that have eggs in them. And then you have antheridia, which produce the sperm. So again, a film of water will allow this to occur. There's usually a pheromone that's produced, as in most cases where these eggs are located, and a pheromone that the sperm are actually attracted to. So that sort of guides them during the fertilization process. And once fertilization occurs, the zygote forms, and you get this little sporophyte growing off the top. So there you have the gametophyte phase and the sporophyte. Here's a sample of that. There's, again, the prothallus is over here. Here's the antheridia, or usually at the top of that. And at the base, you'll find the archegonia. That's shown over here in this. So this is one of the sperm. When I took that off and under my scope, it's curlicued. It has a curlicue shape to it. But they're active swimmers. So they swim around, and that's what it looks like over here if you were to look and enlarge it. And it has multiple flagella. These are the parts that allowed it to propel it through the water as they swim. So multiple sperm are released, an egg gets fertilized, and then eventually what you get, here you can show a close-up, there's the antheridia with the sperm inside, and here's the archegonia, which kind of hang up on the bottom side of the frond. Here fertilization has occurred, and there's the gametophyte, and then here's the sporophyte. So this is a sporophyte, so that's diploid. and this is haploid tissue out here. So again, there's a mix, you get them both together. And this occurs in nature. I mean, it actually occurs if the conditions are right.
It's wonderful.
So fern propagation, you can do vegetative budding, rhizome division, which is the most common way to propagate these ferns. You can do it from spores like I did, and you can do it from, of course they do it now with tissue culture, which they can do a lot more with it. So again, divisions, you can do that. That's one of the normal ways of dividing your plant. So if you buy a plant at the plant sale and you see, you can actually do a division then if you want to make some multiple plants. So you can get $5, $10, $15 worth of ferns by just doing the division at the time you plant it. Sorry, Chris. Yeah, Ruby. Or you just buy it. So the way I collected the spores, now I just sowed them on the medium. You can use various ways. You can use a little pot like this. I have sphagnum moss inside that's wetted. And you can spread the spores on this and put a covering over it, a glass jar or something, and you can watch the spores germinate. You can buy little peat pellets like this that expand, and you can buy actually little cones like this that you can keep them moist. The idea is to keep the moisture up on them as they germinate. So it holds the moisture. Usually a north-facing window, full shade. Wait 6 to 8 weeks if you can be patient. And the prothalli and then thin 1 to 2 inches. You want to thin them off because you get too many on there. I'll show you an example of an error on my part. Another 6 to 8 weeks and you should see the first fronds. Yes?
I just have a question. If you propagate just by division, does it still have to be in the north facing window?
Well, usually most of the ferns around here are usually shade.
Right,
so, yeah, it's usually shade oriented ferns. We do have some that do well in the sun, but a lot of our natives do really well in shade or part shade.
Right.
Yeah.
But I mean, does it have to be a north?
No, as long as it's shade. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I
did this during the winter, so a lot of times you can't set them outside. So a north window is better than a sunny window if you're trying to do this. Yeah. So that's the reason for that. Keep moist with a spray bottle. Always kept a spray bottle available. So here's how I capture it. So here's the Christmas fern, the one I've just passed around, and you see the sori here at the top, the fertile penny. And I laid them on a sheet of paper, and the spore side is down on the paper. And then with time, after they dried, it left this spore pattern. So I lifted these off. These fronds were lifted off, and try not to disturb it, but you can see most of these are the spores that have dropped out of the frond. And then I just folded the paper up and you can collect the spores then in mass. And so most of the ferns over here, if you put them on a piece of paper, you can capture those spores. So as you can tell though, it's kind of intense and it probably takes a nut like me to try this, but it's a fun exercise to have. So here's basically what I did, again, bricks. And I use these little containers like this, which are really quite nice, let the light in. And I had them lined up under lights. I did this during the winter. And then you can see the prothalli on the brick starting to grow. And here we have actually what occurred when I sprayed it. I provided the water. So Antheridia gave rise to sperm and Archegonia to eggs. And sure enough, we got fertilization and there's the little sporophyte coming off. This is a frond of moss, which had grown there along the brick. And here, yes?
Question. From laying the spores dropping off the...
Right.
Okay, and then you put it on the brick.
Mm-hmm.
Or your...
The spores, just spread
the
spores, over.
Yeah, put the spores. How long does it take for it to germinate? And do you keep it wet?
6 to 8 weeks.
6 to 8 weeks, yeah. And you wet it once a week or
something? Well, make sure the brick stays wet and moist, okay. Yeah, all the time, yeah. And with a cover like this, it's easy to do. You don't have to do a lot with it, yeah. So if we go back here, you can see that 6 to 8 weeks for the prothallite, once the spore germinates, 6 to 8 weeks. and then another 6 to 8 weeks before fertilization maybe has occurred, and you get a frond that begins to form on the spore plant.
When do you plant? In the spring?
In the spring, let's go on back. So here you can see one, I've spread the spores nicely, and these are the prothalli here, but this one, that's too many spores. It's just solid green. There's no way you can separate those out. So using a brush of some sort, you don't take the spores and just sprinkle them because it just in mass drop out. So a brush that has a few spores attached, you can kind of paint it on the surface and get a nice spread on the spores. Any questions about that? So that's again just an experiment. It's fun to try if you want to try it. Easy to do. So let's look at a few unusual ones. Here's the sensitive fern. This is taken in a rain garden, and it has it's dioecious, but it has a dimorphic form. And by dimorphic, I mean that it has the frond. This is the vegetative frond of the sensitive fern. And then it has a separate shoot that produces the sporangia on it. So this dies down. The first frost hits, this goes. This is why it's sometimes called the sensitive fern. And the sporangia here then release spores. So that stands up differently. And if you look at the ostrich fern, which is be available at the plant sale, right in the middle here you will see there are sporophylls that are developing, quite different than what the vegetative frond looks like. But there's another one. This all dies down in the winter, and these things stand up and remain, add a little texture to your garden. So it's a plant that'll be available.
So you leave the fronds that die down until spring?
Yeah. Usually you leave that up. I've learned now not to clear my garden anything until spring. I begin to see something beginning to grow. Leave that texture there. So this has creeping rhizomes, so it does spread, but interesting. There's another view of it there. So again, it's very sensitive to frost. And these are all the sterile fronds. So again, this is the sporophyte phase. Here's the fertile fronds, as I just showed you. Here's the winter look to it. So they stand up and usually don't cut those off. Here's a royal fern that's in the middle of my rain garden. I just showed you that frond over there. Does quite well there. Here's the Carolina mosquito fern, which is a water fern called water velvet, Azalea carolinia. And it's growing here in the middle. This is duckweed. So a lot of ponds you see have duckweed on them now. But this mosquito fern will sometimes come in attached to duck feet, get spread from pond to pond, so that's how it gets around. So here's what it looks like. So it's quite unique in terms of the fronds. It floats on the surface of the water, as you see. And there's a nitrogen-fixing alga that grows in the leaf itself and actually fixes nitrogen. And it diffuses into the water area, but it's an interesting symbiotic relationship between the blue-green alga and the fern. This is also true of cycads. And you know a cycad, it has a blue-green alga that's associated with it also. So these symbiotic relationships occur in nature. Lichens are the same way. There are three different kinds of alga that have been found associated with lichens, with a fungus. So these are not quite as usual. There's another salvinia, which is another interesting floating fern. See the root system here underneath. This is what it kind of looks like drawn out. This becomes a noxious pest, particularly over in Africa, where they have a lot of the lakes that have been covered with this, and they actually have to come in and bale it. I mean, it also cuts out the light that penetrates deep. So it affects, you know, the biota in the water itself. So it can be quite problematic for them. This shows the whole group of them growing here. You can see just a mat on the surface of the water. This is the common salvinia. Here's the Azalea, just to compare. There's the Azalea over here, and this is salvinia. Both of these, again, aquatic ferns that float on the surface. Another one that's interesting, we don't have it found regularly here in North Carolina, but this is the Marsilia quadrifolia, which is sometimes called water clover, and it has leaves that float to the surface, and you can see it has four pinnae on it, and it sure looks like a four-leaf clover on it, and from where it gets its name. But it has, the reproductive structures are formed in the base of the plant, and this is where fertilization and occurs at the base of the plant, not out of the water, but so it's always in the water. So it's has unusual sort of sporocarps, they're called, that form. And these will lay dormant in the pond. This will die back during the winter, and then those will germinate, and you'll get a new introduction of Marsilia. We have a climbing fern that's sometimes found at the coastal area, Lagodium, which is invasive, and you can see what happens. It grows all over. So if you have this, you want to beware of the climbing. Climbing ferns can get out of hand, so Lagodium. And this is a favorite of mine, the northern maidenhair, with its pinnae, and it can be quite, this is the northern form. We have the Miris form, which is over here, which will be at the plant sale, so should have that available there. Here it is here, Maris southern maidenhair. Yeah, so it's really nice. It has a really dark petioles on it, really stand out. This is a common one in the woodsy area around here in the spring. You'll find the grape fern. It's usually one little frond that sticks above the leaf litter, and then eventually up comes the sporophyll. So it will form. So again, it has this dimorphic form, and this is where the spores are produced here then. So called the grape fern, Botrychium. Now a little bit about tree ferns. If you go over to ANA Plants and go in their greenhouse, you'll find that these, they actually have these for sale. Not Dickersonia, but the Scythia is available. You can buy them. They're not native here, and they don't do well outside here. But some people evidently have a market for them. They buy them for more, in open apiaries or so forth that you might find them. So this is the Australian tree fern, and then this is the 65 feet tall. So these are ferns that get pretty large and continue to grow. This was one taken back in 1966 when I was in New Zealand, and my advisor standing here, and we were in a little gully tree fern forest, and I took this picture so you can see the stems in there and the size of them. So unfortunately, we were on our way to Antarctica, and we got laid over there for a whole week with nothing to do on the South Island of New Zealand. So we had to travel around. So this is the interesting distribution of that particular Scythia plant, the ferns. You can see where they're located. So these are the current populations are found here and over here and in the Indonesian area, southern part of east side of Australia and New Zealand. So it's an interesting distribution pattern. And how do you explain this distribution pattern? Knowing that they only produce by spores.
Wind.
Do you think that wind carries them across?
Ships.
Could be ships. That's one possibility, right? But anyway, these are sort of native populations. They've not been transplanted there by anybody. But we've come to think a little bit outside the box. And let's think about continental drift. So Pangaea, about 300 million years ago, this is where the continents were aligned. So you can see where they overlap, and that's how these distributions now are explained. It's just not this plant, but many, many plants are explained by the fact that when this particular area, the seas around it, and these were emerging continents that have not yet spread due to continental drift, then we have that distribution pattern. So they get separated and they travel right with the plates as they migrate. And of course, that's still going on, i.e. volcanism, earthquakes. We're still continuing with this developing worldwide. Continental drift still occurring. So let's switch gears a little bit and talk about the plant sale coming up. Wednesday, September 19th, 9 to 6. Right here in this room, It'll be right here, right?
Absolutely.
So, go back here. This is the list that's available. Chris has added the Christmas ferns. There'll be some Christmas ferns available. But you see most of these are not native here. Ostrich fern is the native one. So that's the only one we have on there that will be native. And that's the example of it over there. It's in the pot. So that's the Christmas fern. And again, a shout out to this particular document, which you'll want to download and print off, which is, again, if you send me an email, I'll send you, you can get to the link to this University of Georgia, Growing Ferns. It was updated in 2015, so it's not out of date. It's a well-done document. It covers temperature, humidity, light potting, watering, the media that you pot it in, the grooming, pest problems, if there are any, some terminology, native fern species. They give sources for native ferns in the back, so it's a good source if you want to look for that, and then, of course, references. So, and then over at the side over here, when you leave, you can scroll through the books I have over there on ferns. So University of Georgia did a great job on this. So, and this is the sheet I've talked about. If you have this, these are all active links. So I'll send it, look just like this when you get an email, and you can just click on those. It'll take you right out to those right there. And again, my email address is right at the bottom there, if you would like a copy. And the back again is, again, from a list from Mellencamp's book on native plants of the Southeast. So this is a really great, great book, and it has the list of the ferns inside here. So if you're interested in looking at that. And it does cover all the sort of native ferns that we have here, and some of their requirements are checked off over here. And he put the little asterisks by it on how well they do in the area, so kind of gives us a heads up. So it's in this book, Native Plants of the Southeast. So back to Dicksonia. This is down in Australia. The way these fern forests look. And if you were there about 120 million years ago, it would look something like this. So here's a Microraptor in the fern forest 120 million years ago. And you can see the fiddlehead, crow's ear here, so, and the fern frond. So Dicksonia has been around a long time and is still prevalent in that area of the world. And again, if we look at we look at this again, the ferns coming in about 320 million years ago. One of the interesting things about ferns, if you look at the asteroid and comet impacts, these are the major ones that have been recorded based on, again, geological history and geological finds. These are impacts that have occurred either from comets or asteroids that have hit the Earth. They haven't missed. They've hit the Earth. So these have been recorded with time, and of course the big one came here about 65 million years ago, and that's the one that basically wiped out the dinosaurs. So there's a PBS Nova edition on this very impact crater that occurred in the time. They've documented it really well. So if we look at a different little level, so here's 545 million years ago. Go up the scale to current time up here. We look at sea level. We talk about sea level changes that have occurred over time. We got a good record of what's going on in the seas and the changes that have occurred. And here's that big Crux Lube impact that occurred and wiped out all the dinosaurs. These are also meteorites that have been documented and hit all the way along. Notice the ferns occurred here. We have Selaginella a little before in that history. Ginkgo, you recognize the ginkgo tree, it occurred about this time. And the tree forests were present and are still present, of course. But all of these impacts that have occurred have destroyed. We've lost a lot of plants and a lot of animals due to those impacts. And luckily, the ferns have survived. Multiple impacts from these impact meteorites that have hit. So we've got mass extinctions going on. It's a continuing process. It continues to go on. Some of it's due to climate, of course, meteorite impacts, volcanism, which is still well occurring all around the world, air temperature changes, ocean acidification that's occurring. That's a continual problem now with our corals that are dying because of the acidification of the oceans. Oxygen levels in the water, sea level rise. A report this morning from Louisiana about a marine lab that's right on the coast there, and that floods, and they can't get to their marine lab because the area is flooding, and they have to wait till the water goes down to get to their lab. So again, they're totally impacted by this sea level rise that's occurring. So anyway, these mass extinctions are going to continue to occur, and it's always occurring. So if we don't survive, the ferns and their fabulous fawns will. So we can go through mass extinction, brush fires, which now are prevalent, as you know, on the West Coast, severe drought, which is also occurring out there. So again, ferns have proven, based on time, that these are survivors. So we need to learn lessons from the ferns. So any questions? So again, you can see the pinnule. These are individual. This is one spike coming off here. And you see this little line right here? This is interesting. You'll see this on a lot of ferns. Those are pores along there that allow the exchange of air, carbon dioxide and oxygen. This little stripe or line that occurs along there. So here we go. Hand-roasted chicken with garlic mashed potatoes. Is this what you had to eat?
Well, not exactly.
Not exactly.
Those things.
See those? Yeah. So here's the source of those things. These croziers are coming from the Royal Osmunda Regulares. Regulares. And there, here's the... So they come along and snip these off, and then they cook them and serve them up. So, so there's my contact information. Again, it's on the bottom of the handout. Thank you so much for coming. And again, take a look at the books and look at the ferns. I've got them all labeled up here. So any questions? Yes.
Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.